Hello friends, this is Vasant Nayak from Vastech channel. Please subscribe to our channel. We will update latest information for you. Thank you.
Hello students, in this class we will see the connection oriented transport, that is TCP. So we know TCP is a reliable data transfer protocol. So some of the important points related to TCP is it is a connection oriented protocol. That means before transmitting data, it will establish the connection, that is called as three-way handshake. So as a part of connection establishment, both sides of the connection will initialize many parameters. These parameters are called as TCP state variables. So we know TCP connection is not an end-to-end TDM or FDM connection. It is not a virtual circuit connection. It is established on the end host. It is not established on the intermediate host like router, switches, etc. So in between router, switches will not maintain TCP variables, or it will not maintain TCP connection state. So TCP is a point-to-point connection, one sender and one receiver. So point-to-multipoint or point-to-multicast is very difficult to achieve in one operation in TCP. TCP is a full duplex data transfer, that means it is a bidirectional data transfer. TCP is a reliable in-order byte stream. There is no message boundaries for the TCP. So as a connection establishment, you know there are two processes. One is a server process, other one is a client process. Initially, client process sends initial segment, a special segment to the server. Server process will reply for that one with the special segment. And the third segment from the client side may contain payload or data. Now this is called as three-way handshake. Now the connection is established. After the connection is established, TCP will now try to send the data. So it will try to send the data from the process through socket. For that, it will maintain connection buffer on the sender side as well as on the receiver side. So all these datas are stored in this buffer, and TCP will grab the data from the buffer as required into segment, and the size of the segment is depends on type of the link, like Ethernet link or other type of link, and it is called as a maximum transmission unit. So MTU for Ethernet is 1000 bytes. So other than that, TCP provides congestion control and flow control. These are the important terms related to TCP. Now we will see TCP structure, address structure in the next slide. You can see here TCP address structure. The TCP address structure contains around 20 bytes if you exclude option. So like IP header, TCP header is also 20 bytes and of a width of 32 bits, that is 4 bytes. So this is width is 4 bytes and there are 5 rows are there. So option is a variable length and this is data. So header contains 4 into 5, that means 20 bytes. What are the important points in the headers? One is the source port and destination port. TCP works on transport layer. Transport layer makes use of port address, we know, for multiplexing and demultiplexing. So 16 bits are assigned for source port and 16 bits are assigned for destination port. So 16-bit 2:16, that is 65,536 ports combinations are possible, either source port or destination port. Other than that, 32 bits are allotted for sequence number and acknowledgement number. TCP is a reliable data transfer, so it can achieve reliability by using sequence numbers. That is, it will number the segment whichever sending segment, it will number it by using one number that is called sequence number. For the particular sequence number which it has sent, it will expect acknowledgement. As soon as the acknowledgement comes, that means the segment is delivered properly to the sender. So 32 bits are allocated for the segment sequence number and acknowledgement number. Then receive window. Receive window is for the flow control. So this tells the size of the receiver window. By this one, TCP sender will control the flow. Checksum. Checksum is the checksum of the data. URG data pointer, urgent data pointer. Other than that, you have something called as flags. The flags are, one is URG flag that indicates the data has to be delivered to the upper layer, indicated by the sending side entity. Push. Push data, PSH, data now, generally not used, push data indicates the data has to be delivered to the upper layer. Then other than that, we have reset, sync and finish. All these are to reset the connection, terminate the connection, establish the connection. Other than that, we have checksum. So this is the TCP segment structure. So you may ask, what is this exactly? See, you know, when the data comes from the upper layer, this is the upper layer, you indicate, you think like this is the upper layer application. When the data comes from the application to the transport layer will divide the data into small segment, and each segment it will add the adder. So this adder is called as TCP adder. So this adder contains the information. All this information, this is data. So segment is nothing but adder plus a data. Now sequence number and acknowledgement numbers. TCP makes use of sequence numbers. TCP is a byte stream. TCP is a byte stream of data. That means TCP views data as an unstructured but ordered stream of bytes. That is, it views data as an unstructured but ordered stream of bytes. TCP uses sequence numbers for the each byte and not over the series of transmitted segments. The sequence number for a segment is therefore the byte stream number of the first byte in the segment. That means, suppose you take, this is the stream of data. This is the stream of data. You'll take this is the stream of data. The stream of data is divided into bytes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bytes. Just imagine 5 bytes makes one segment. Once again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, this is 0th bytes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then this becomes 10. Then this becomes 15. This is 10. This is 11 actually. Now, this is the first segment, and what is the number of the first segment? Number of the first segment is 0, sequence number. Number of the second segment is 5. That is, the 5 sequence number is assigned to this 5th byte. This is the sequence number. Just think, I am giving example. This is the sequence number assigned to this byte. Then that is the segment number. So like this it works. So while sending data, outgoing segment from the sender contains the sequence number. For example, in the diagram you can see here, this one has got particular sequence number. That number is allocated in the sequence number field in the adder. On the other end, Acknowledgement also carries acknowledgement number. Other than that, the flag bit is at A. You know, we'll go back to our previous slide. See here, one flag bit is there, A. This indicates the it is an acknowledgement for the particular segment received. So, here you can see when the acknowledgement comes, that one not only contains the acknowledgement number, it will indicate that particular segment is the acknowledgement. So, now we will see sequence numbers. So, here host A and host B, host A user type C. For that, acknowledgement also types acknowledgement, host B acknowledgement for that one. In receipts of C, he also echoes back C. Now, how it works? Initially, we will take sequence number 42 and acknowledgement number 79. We will take like this and data is equal to C. As soon as received, then host B will tell something like that. I have received your sequence number 43. Send me sequence number 42. Send me sequence number 43. So acknowledgement 43 means send me sequence number 43. And this is my sequence number. So you may ask how this sequence number 79 came here. You just see here in the reverse way. Acknowledgement number 79 received from the host A says he has received 78 and he is expecting 79 from B. So this is the sequence number in related to this one. This is the sequence number, acknowledgement number in related to this sequence number. So here you can see now sequence number is 43. And acknowledgement number 80, that means it expects sequence number 80 from B to A. That is the meaning. This is one scenario to understand how sequence number and acknowledgement numbers works. Let me repeat once again here. Initially, you have to take some value, sequence number 42, acknowledgement 79 and data. Now, this is the acknowledgement 79 that indicates host A is telling host B that he has received a sequence number 78 from B and he wants 79 that you can see here. And acknowledgement number 43 indicates from B to A that he has received 42, sequence number 42, and you want sequence number 43, that you can see here. In this way it works. So now next one is TCP makes use of timer. So how this timeout value will be? Timer is used whenever it doesn't receive the acknowledgement for the transmitted packet. Then it cannot wait for long time. It will start the timer as soon as the packet is sent. And when the timer timeouts, it will resend the packet. That is the one way to avoid the... it is the one way for the solution for the loss of acknowledgement. So, but this how this timeout value will be decided? Timeout value will be decided by RTT. Round trip time. We know what is RTT. RTT is the time taken... RTT is the time taken to reach the signal from one end to the other end to get the acknowledgement. So, but this RTT varies. RTT varies based on congestion in the network. So, what is the solution? We cannot take two short timeout value. If you take two short timeout value, unnecessarily it will result in retransmission. Two long timeout value will this segment loss. So, what TCP will do? TCP will take sample RTT. Sample RTT means it will try to measure sample RTT. It will take one value, one segment and it will try to measure the RTT for that segment and that is called a sample RTT. But sample RTT will vary. So, vary. So, in order to smoother it further, it will TCP will try to find out estimated RTT. So, estimated RTT is nothing but to find out the estimated RTT, the formula is this one and the value of alpha is this one and in the year you can see sample RTT variation and estimated identity variation. Now, there is a deviation of sample RTT from the estimated RTT. So we need to find out once again deviation RTT. So for that we have one more formula, that is deviation RTT is equal to 1 minus beta into deviate RTT, something like this, where beta is taken 0.25. So once you calculate deviate RTT, then timeout interval will be measured by something like this. This is the timeout interval. So TCP reliable data transfers. TCP works on unreliable protocol. You know, below the transport layer, there is a network layer. Network layer protocol is IP. IP is an unreliable best effort protocol. So TCP depends on IP. That is, reliabilities depend on unreliability. That is the point you have to remember. So TCP makes use of different methodology, that is called as pipeline segment, cumulative acknowledgement, single retransmission timer, timeout events, duplicate acknowledgements, all these. So as soon as the data received from the application, it will create the segment, and for the segment it will assign the sequence number, and it will transmit the segment. It will start the timer. On expiration of interval, it will transmit the segment. Once the acknowledgement is received, it will update what is known to be acknowledged. So all these things will happen here. So you can see here, data received from the application above, what TCP will do? It will create the segment with the sequence number, next sequence number, and the pass the segment to the IP. Next sequence number is next sequence number plus length of the data, length of the data. If the timer is currently not running, start the timer. Then if the timeout occurs and not at acknowledgement received, start the retransmit and start the timer. If the acknowledgement is received, and if the value of the acknowledgement is greater than send base, then it will equate send base is equal to Y. And if there are currently not at acknowledgement segments are there, it will start the timer, else it will stop this timer. In this way, TCP FSM proceeds. So one point to remember here, for example, if it receives acknowledgement Y, for example, this is the send base, and it received acknowledgement, it received acknowledgement for this segment. You know, TCP makes use of cumulative acknowledgement. If the Y is greater than send base, then send base is Y. That means these many segments are acknowledged. So now my send base becomes this one. This becomes send base. If there are currently not at ACK segment, start this timer, else stop the timer.